and then Monty will come up and read after that. Praise be to the Lord God, the God of Israel, who alone does marvelous deeds. Praise be to his glorious name forever. May the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen.
Today I'm reading from John 14, 1 through 6. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Let's pray. God, thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. Thank you for giving us the freedom in this country to come together and worship you as a congregation. And please put it in our hearts to help those who don't have that freedom so that they may come to know you, because you are the only way to the Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Happy 4th of July, almost. I was hot enough as a firecracker anyway, so. All right, well, it's only supposed to be 102 to 108 again this next week, so make sure your AC is working well and stay cool. And it's a good time to read the Bible. You know, get you a nice cool spot, a good glass of lemonade, and sit down and just get with God. All right, he's our friend. So hey, let's stand and sing Friend of God. What a good intro there, huh? Amazing, who am I that you are mindful of me? Well, it is amazing. His love is amazing. That he cares so much for us. All right. In Christ alone. Be seated. Excuse me. God.
not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent, immortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give. And by your plan, that's just the way. God alone from before time began. You were on your throne and you were God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne and you are God alone. That's just the way it is. And you are God alone from before time began. And you are on your throne and you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, and you are on your throne, you are God. You're unshakable, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, unshakable, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. And you are God alone, from before time began, you are on your throne, and you were God alone. Right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, and you are God alone. You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable. That's what you are.
Father God, we thank you so much for allowing us to come and worship you this morning. We're so thankful that you are on your throne and that we're not. We're so thankful that you're immutable, you're unchangeable, you're unshakable, Lord, that you see the beginning and the end all at once, and you know what's going to happen. We're so thankful that you sent your Son, Lord, to show us not only how to live, Lord, but to redeem us from sins that we could not do ourselves. Father God, we pray that this morning that you would give us ears to hear your word, that we would be changed by your word, transformed into the people that you called us to be. And Father God, we're so thankful for your patience and your care and your loving kindness towards us as that process occurs. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Show this morning, I want to give him an opportunity to get the sound on. For by all means, we need sound when I preach. So
I know we turned him all the way down, but we recorded louder.
Just for the sake of Facebook, that we have sound. If you take your scripture this morning and journey with me in the study of God's word,
1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to look at two passages of Scripture this morning, verses 18 and 19. And as you're making your way there, I was just reminding again of the goodness of God and freedoms that we share in Christ Jesus through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Though I appreciate our forefathers and for the sacrifice that was made long before our time, that we have a country that we are freely engaging in worship how we see fit, I think of the freedom that we have in Christ, and nothing is a substitute for that. I'm not sure.
We're going to figure this out. Thank the Lord for freedom. Just as we were beginning to prepare for this morning, I just found it extremely encouraging to hear from Ken about his mother-in-law, Betty Kennard, and her passing. And I just can't hardly believe that outside of Christ, we can even exist. I know that it's possible because we see it all around us, but just to think about the hope, even in the face of death. And he was just expressing his celebratory heart of how her funeral was not a time of mourning, although there was a great loss. But the loss was for us, the gain was for her. And just that concept of hope that we have in Christ. And Christians of all people ought to be the first to celebrate the going home of a loved one or a dear friend. How do we do that? And how do we express that in the life in which we live outside of Christ? Well, we don't. And so I think that's the point that we're going to jump from this morning, is the Apostle Peter is going to again express to us some motivations for the salvation that God has granted to us through the shed blood, his own shed blood at Calvary. Those motivations started, as you well know, back in verse 13, and they come in the form of exhortations or commands. And the first thing that we saw was that we were to fix our hope and our salvation in a future glory, an inheritance that awaits us. In verse 14, we are to forsake our former passions. In verses 15 and 16, we are to pursue holiness, for he is holy, therefore we are called to be holy. And then last week in verse 17, we are to love the Father and fear his judgments. And we looked at what it meant to fear and to honor God. And so we began in hope, and then we graduated into holiness, and then we arrived last week into honor or into reverence. Both in reverence and awe of who Christ is and what he has done for us, but a fear that we in some way at any time would be disqualified by the life that we live and dishonor his name by the sin that is very pervasive in the life of even a believer who yields to it. And so we looked at those passages of Scripture, having come off of that out of the heels of verses 1 through 12, the doctrine of salvation. We talked about election. We talked about security. We talked about pain and suffering. And lastly, we left with those things that the prophets would study, and they would stand in awe of the salvation granted to those in Christ Jesus. The grace that has come in the person of Christ. And angels would, with a long neck, they would stretch forth and they would long to look at and identifying those things that only those of us in creation as humanity in Christ Jesus would ever experience through the love of Jesus Christ. Well, this morning we're going to look at verses 18 and 19, and really it's a four-part. We're going to break it into two Sundays, but really 18 through 21 is the context, and there are four questions that are asked and answered in these passages. What we have been redeemed from, verse 18. Verse 19, what did God redeem us with? Verse 19. Verse 20, who redeemed us? And verse 21, what purpose were we redeemed? This morning we're going to deal with the first of those four questions, what we have been redeemed from, and what did God redeem us with? It makes a difference in what we believe about the gospel or the doctrine of redemption. And so I want to tell you that this morning I drew from an old Puritan saying, and Thomas Watson said something many, many years ago that has always resonated when I first saw this as a young pastor. Quote, he says this about God's greatest work in redemption. Great was the work of creation, but greater the work of redemption. It costs more to redeem us than to make us. He spoke creation into existence with a word, but he brought us back, he bought us back in redemption with his strong arm. End of quote. This morning we're going to talk about the thing that sometimes we oftentimes neglect in the church. I'll be honest, we oftentimes don't use the word redeemed. And so when somebody walks up to you, we're quick to say, well, I'm born again, and that is a true statement, or I'm saved, or I'm a child of God. And all those are true statements, and I don't want you to neglect that. But how about the next time somebody asks you who you are in Christ, you just say, I'm redeemed. What is it to be redeemed by Jesus Christ, and what did it cost him to redeem us or to buy us back? And who is it that we celebrate today in this truth, the redemption made whole in Christ Jesus? Beginning in verse 17 is where we'll pick up our text, because it brings us into where we're going to study today. And if you address as Father the one who impartially judges according to each man's work, conduct yourselves in fear during the time of your stay upon earth. Verse 18. Knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood as of a lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. Verse 20. For he was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but has appeared in these last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Father, we thank you for this day and for the provision of your grace and the study of your word. But Father, we are going to confess to you in total agreement with you that we cannot come to understanding on any passage of Scripture outside of the instruction of the Spirit of God, your person. So God, we're relying on you. We're asking you to bring us into a place of understanding that we can fully grasp who we are and what you have done for us. And Father, in so doing, that not only would we fall prostrate in front of you and worship, but we would live a life that would exemplify the person for whom we were bought by, your Son, Jesus Christ. So it's in his name we offer this prayer. Amen. The first thing we're going to see is, from what were we redeemed from? We have to go back to verse 14, because there's four characteristics that Peter is going to lay out to us of what we've been rescued out of, or what we've been bought by God out of. Look at verse 14. He gives us two indicators about what we used to be in the former man. As obedient children, do not be conformed or molded to your former lust, one, which was yours in ignorance, too. You know, the value of grace and the value of the redemptive work at Calvary is best viewed through the lens of what we used to be. We see the depth of God's grace in what he rescued us and what he bought us out of. Oftentimes, we want to go immediately to the love of God, and that's perfectly okay. But do you understand that if we're going to teach the full counsel of the saving work of Jesus Christ, the depravity of man has to be taught. It has to be taught what we were, what we used to be. Paul does it most masterfully in Ephesians in chapter 2. He takes three of those first verses and he tells us what we used to be. We were dead in our trespasses and sin. Then he gives a whole list of things that we used to be identified with. These are characteristics of a lost person. These are characteristics of those outside of the commonwealth of God's grace. And so Peter does the same transaction in the handling of the word. He begins in 14, he says, you used to be bound to and driven by the lust of your flesh. You used to be ignorant to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then he's going to give us two more definitions of a former life outside of the redemptive hope in Jesus Christ. He says, I want you to remember these things because I want you to see what you were redeemed out of. No man can come in here and say, well, I've always loved God. I can't remember a time in which I didn't love God. No, my dear friends, you were an enemy of the cross. You were in defilement of what God did, and you stood as a transgressor, a dead man walking. That's scriptural. And so if you're going to teach the gospel of Jesus Christ, we must deal with what we were redeemed from. I can't even imagine on this day, and I'm just going to be extremely transparent. I'm not going to focus on anybody in this room so everybody can relax. But for me, I can't even imagine where I would be today outside of the redemptive plan of Jesus Christ. What, I would still be dead in my trespasses, but my life would be a wreck. I was well on that road. I was headed well on a fast track to a place of absolute destruction. You say, well, really? Yeah, and so are all of you outside of Christ. You say, well, I wasn't a criminal. Yeah, really? We transgressed the law of God, therefore we stood condemned according to God's word. He says, the lust of your flesh, you've been freed from it. He says the ignorance of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you're now no longer ignorant of what Christ did for you. But then he starts talking about a knowledge. Eido is the word in the Greek. That means a satisfied place of satisfaction. You fully have understanding of these things that I'm going to teach you that you were redeemed from. Guys, the lens by which the image that Peter would draw from would be both in a Gentile way, because there were Gentile Christians that would receive this letter, but there are also Jewish people that would receive this letter. By what lens would those two groups of people begin to look at what they knew to be true about the redemptive history? I want to just maybe throw something out for you. There are many places, you know, that from Genesis in chapter 1, verse 1, until the final word in the Revelation, it is all a story of Jesus Christ and salvation. The meta-narrative of all Scripture focuses on the purpose and work of Jesus Christ, finished at Calvary, secured for us in the resurrection. It's all his story. When I hear people say, well, you know, the main character in the book of whatever is, and they'll name some man or some woman. No, the main character in every book is Jesus Christ. Even in the book that you guys are dealing with, in the book of Esther, it never brings up the word God or Jesus or the Son or the Spirit. Nothing that's going to characterize that and specifically tie it to God. But the person that most drives the book of Esther is God's sovereignty in time. To preserve for himself a remnant, a people. And how did he do it? He raised people up at a given time for a given purpose. But the meta-narrative, the focus of the book, is God is a sovereign, holy God, and he is a covenant-keeping Father. So whether you look at whatever book, you just know that the main focus is going to be the person and work of Jesus Christ. Well, one of the very first places we see this dynamic, at least for the Jews, and I want you to turn there for just a minute, is in Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12, beginning in verse 1, I want to show you a substitutionary act on behalf of a people in bondage. We're in Egypt in bondage. We are set apart from our land. Where are the people in 1 Peter? Sojourners in a foreign land. I think the imagery is most clearly seen in one of the first examples of a lamb that was substituted for really the death of the firstborn males, both children and animals. For what purpose? That they might historically go back on a day every single year, and they would honor and praise God for the substitutionary sacrifice that led them out of bondage. Pharaoh says, you can't go. God says, oh, let my people go. No, he's not going to let us go. All right. We pick up the narrative in Scripture, and I want you to see that the imagery that Peter would be using would be viewing through that which the Jews knew. And I'm going to show you why I think this in just a moment. And he says, now the Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, this month, and we know it's the month of Nisan, and this month shall be the beginning of months for you. It is to be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, they are each one to take a lamb for themselves, according to their father's households, and a lamb for each household. Now, if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his neighbor nearest to him, his house, are to take one according to the number of persons in them. According to what each man should eat, you shall to divide the lamb, and your lamb shall be an unblemished male, a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall know it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel is to kill it at twilight. Moreover, they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. And they shall eat the flesh that same night, roasted with fire, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled at all with water, but rather roasted with fire, both its head and its legs, along with its entrails. And you shall not leave any of it over until morning, but whatever is left until the morning, you shall burn with fire. Now you shall eat it in this manner, with your loins girded. Have we not seen this language already in 1 Peter? Gird your loin for action. He said, this is a preparation. You are to act upon this, and you need to be prepared to flee. What a promise in Scripture. They don't even really know the fullness of what this means. And he says, take that outer garment, wrap it underneath your belt. You're going to put your sandals on. You're going to gird your loins because you're going to be delivered. A promise of hope. And he says, to gird. And now you shall eat in this manner, gird your loins, your sandals on your feet, your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. Hurry up, kids. Have you ever heard that at the dining room table? We've got places to go and things to do. Eat your food. Yeah, that's what he's saying. Get it eaten. And he says, it is the Lord's Passover. For I will go through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. And you shall see the blood. And I shall see the blood and pass over you. And no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Now listen to 14. Now this day will be a memorial to you. And you shall celebrate it as a feast to the Lord. Throughout your generations you are to celebrate it as a permanent ordinance. The Passover. My dear friends, this is what the Jews would know. They would have an intimate knowledge of what they executed as a memorial standard from that day every single year. The deliverance of God through the shed blood of a lamb that was purchased for one purpose, to be the sacrifice as a Passover reminder. I will not destroy you, but I will deliver you. Folks, when we get to this passage in 18, they had a persuaded understanding. They knew that Jesus Christ was that foreshadow, was that example all the way back in the writings of Exodus. See the pen of Moses. And every year, just as they do today, in their futility, Jews arrive on the 14th day of Nisan, and they take a precious, unblemished lamb. Now, we don't have a sacrificial system at this time, do we? We don't have a temple. But every year, you know what they remember? A lamb's blood was spilled. Guys, I don't know. We have vets in the building, but I can just imagine for me, I know how I am. I don't want to get left behind by any means. I certainly don't want Keegan, my firstborn son, to be executed by a death angel. And I'm pretty sure we had a dog, a male dog in our house. Didn't want to see that puppy suffer. I don't know how much blood is in a lamb, but it must have been a mess. And he took that branch of hyssop and caught that blood in a basin. And I'm quite certain that every bit of it was spilt on the doorpost and across the mantle, across the lintel, in preparation of a deliverance by the mighty hand of God. And for centuries, the Jews have awaited that lamb. And some 2,000 years ago, a forerunner by the name of John the Baptist, John in chapter 2, he sees Jesus from a distance. And what does he say? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Not a deliverance out of Egypt. Not a passing by of a death angel, but the total execution of the precious Lamb for the sake of salvation for those who would believe. Well, what have we been saved from? Well, let's look at the text. He says, you know these things. You have a full persuasion. You have an understanding. Knowing that you are not redeemed, he uses a negative, knowing that you are not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold. Let's stop right there. He says, you know this, that the redemption that you now are satisfied in Christ, and that God is satisfied in Christ's sacrifice, wasn't just the common perishable coin of gold and silver. The word redemption means to ransom or to pay with a price as a buyback, a purchase back. Can I just tell you that this in the mind of the Jew would look very similar to that account in Exodus chapter 12? But what about the Gentile that was sitting there that really didn't know anything about Levitical law or the Passover celebration? It wasn't really their heritage. Can I just tell you that he uses this to explain that to them also? Because what he has in mind is a slave market. Now listen to me clearly. This is not some critical race theory or some movement into the woke movement. This is our story. This is every man, every woman, every child. If you're a born-again believer, you stood on the precipice of being sold into slavery, a slave of a different master. Jesus looked at his disciples on a day in which he was teaching them. He says, listen, you're going to serve one of two masters. You're either going to serve your father, the devil, or you're going to serve your father, God. You're going to be a slave of somebody. And Peter says, I want you to just be reminded of this, knowing that you are not purchased with just a gold coin or a silver coin. Why? Slave traders would come to every common port throughout the known world. And off of their ships, they would offload men and women and children, boys and girls. And they would march them as a spectacle for the sole purpose of sending them into slavery with the one who could pay the greatest price. But I found something interesting when I started studying this a few weeks ago. In that day, you couldn't have a banknote. They wouldn't take a check. They wouldn't take an IOU or a promissory note, even if you were the wealthiest man in the community. Those slave traders would take one kind of pay, coin. The highest value of treasure and of preciousness to those men who sold those slaves is they wanted to walk away for every slave sold coin to prove it, gold or silver. It was a common trade, a common way. They could go into any port, and they didn't want just the money of the Persians or the Syrians or the Romans. Only coins would buy a slave. And they would begin to bid one after another. And when the market hit the demand that would pay the value of that slave, the gavel would hit. The coin would be received by the seller. And off in slavery would go the slave. Knowing this, you are not bought. With decaying, composing gold or silver, as precious as that may be in your sight, and as precious as you may think that is, oh my dear friends, when compared to what you used to be and what God brought you out of, folks, He bought me out of a slave auction. My master was Satan, and I did the demand. Whatever was demanded of me, that's what I did in my flesh and in my lustful pursuits and in my ignorance of the gospel. That was me. But folks, that was you too. Peter says, look, redeemed from the slave market, not with gold or silver. But he says, you used to, look at the passage, be caught in a futile way of life. The third characteristics of an unbeliever. Yeah, lust. Inordinate desires that can't be satisfied. So we pursue and we pursue and we pursue. Ignorance of the gospel, not knowing. He says, but that's not you. But you used to be. Knowing that you were not redeemed. You were not purchased. You were not ransomed. You were not bought back with corruptible or perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life. You know what the word futile really means? Useless. Good for nothing. Oh man, preach this in most churches and it'll be the last time you get to preach there. It may be today. I don't know. Driven by lust, the desire of the eye and the lust of the flesh, ignorant of the truth of the gospel, a useless way of living, good for nothing. Folks, this is the word of Scripture. I'm not making this up. So if you walk here and say, man, that was hard, Rob, was hard. I'm only a herald. I'm only telling you what's already written. He says it's a useless way of life. It's a life that leads to futility. You're living a life that means nothing. Didn't Jesus teach this? To gain the whole world and to lose your soul, what have you gained? To pursue and pursue and pursue all the things that are earthly and to gather barn after barn after barn, storing up for yourself on earth things that perish. What have you gained? If you gain your soul, you've gained it all. If you lose your soul, you lose it all. Folks, I want you to just think about your life for a second. I want to get personal with you for just a minute because this passage got personal with me, so I think it's only right that I pass it on to you. I wrote down in my journal five things that I pursue more times than not. They'd be characteristic of me. And then I went back and I put an asterisk beside those five things that I pursue most. And I had to measure it off of this passage. Is it decaying or is it eternal? Guys, I'm ashamed to say that out of the top five, I had some. They're going to burn up. I dare say I'm probably not the only one in here. Be honest. Peter says, if your whole life is a pursuit for lust, not knowing God and His Word, living a useless, futile way of lifestyle. And then he gives us one more. Like, that's not enough, right? We probably already, like, our arm is behind our back when we go to reunions, and our uncles thought they were all funny and cute when we were little, and they'd scob your knob, and they would twist your arm almost off. Yeah, I had those uncles too. He gives us a fourth. Not just lust, not just ignorance, and not just a way of futility. Look at the passage. It's not a futile way of life. Inherited from your forefathers. I want to take you to a passage of Scripture for just a minute about this inheritance. One thing we inherited from the first man, Adam, is inherited by every man in Adam. And that is the firstborn Adam gave us something, a really neat prize. Go to Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. So first he's talking about man in general. In Romans 5:12 it says, therefore, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. Guys, nobody gets out of that trap. Nobody gets away from that. There's not a single man, woman, boy, or girl born of a woman. By the way, all are. That's us. Because of one man, Adam, sin entered into all men. Therefore, we're all sinners. So one of the things that we inherited from our forefathers is this nature called sin. But in the religious circle, Jesus spoke about this same thing, teaching his disciples. Go to Matthew chapter 15 very quickly, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. We're just going to read something that I found quite interesting when I was referencing this and cross-sectioning Scripture. Beginning in 15, 7 through 9, tradition and commandments, the traditions of men and the commandments of God. He's talking about religiosity, backdrop against the truth of God's Word. You hypocrites! Rightly did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, wow, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far away from me. But in vain do they worship me, teachings as doctrines the precepts of men. You know, one of the things that we probably have all inherited from our forefathers? Religiosity. Come on. Guys, there's some things I used to think and some things I used to do because that's what was told to me by my father and grandfather, only to find out later that's not exactly what the Bible says. I literally thought the gospel as a kid. Please, I'm going to show my ignorance for just a second. I was that guy in verse 14. I'm going to show my ignorance. When I was a kid, I thought the gospel was you don't drink, you don't smoke, you don't go to pool halls, and you don't date women who did. I thought, if I can stay away from those four things, man, I'm in. Right? And so as a result of that, because I wasn't doing that, there's something I had to do to replace it. Okay, it's not enough just not to do. I had to do something. So I wanted to be going with my father, who opened the door every Sunday, unlocked the building, turned on the lights, got the heat or the air conditioner on, depending on the type of weather we had outside, and he was the last one to leave. He'd kill the lights and lock the door. I wanted to be that person because I thought that had to be a gateway to heaven. Narrow is the way that leads to salvation. Few find it. But broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many find it. You know, one of the things my forefathers left me, and I pray to God, one of the things every single day, and Wendy is my witness, that I'm not that kind of dad to my sons and daughters. That I will preach Christ crucified. I will preach him resurrected. And I will preach him ascended on high with promise of return every single day. Guys, I don't want your religion. I don't want my religion. I don't want the lies. I don't want the fantasies. I don't want just the perfect illustration that really doesn't mean anything in Scripture. He says, knowing this, that you were not ransomed, you were not bought back with corrupted things like silver or gold. Out of your futile way of life. Oh, and by the way, some of the things your forefathers left for you. And then there's a little connective word. What was I redeemed from? And then verse 19. Guys, anytime you see but in the Word of God, fall on your knees and say hallelujah. That's what we've been saved from. That's the old man crucified with Christ that I might live unto him. Well, what was I saved with? What did it cost to buy me off the slave auction? We've talked about this before, my dad being a horse trader. People would say, what's that horse worth? You've heard this a million times. I've said it here a bunch. Well, what is that horse worth, Richard? What are you willing to pay for it? That's what it's worth. Folks, have you ever looked at a slave auction and just for a moment put yourself in the center of that stage? In the world and all of its futility and the lust and all of its desires and the ignorance of not knowing who Christ is and the inheritance of your religion is bidding one coin after another until you have stockpiled many silver and gold coins and the bidding goes on and on and on. And then all of a sudden, from a distance, behold, the Lamb of God. He shows up and he says, I bought him. Really, what are you going to pay for him? Look at the text. Scripture then turns the table. He says in verse 19, but not with perishable things. That's what he's referring back to, like silver or gold, but with precious blood. Now, I want to show you something in Scripture, and I want you to, you can use this any single time that you are going to look at God's Word and study it. Look at what goes before blood. It's not just blood. Guys, sacrifice was made every single year on the Day of Atonement. In celebration of Passover, a lamb. Literally, it means to mutilate. It means to slit the throat. That's the blood we're talking about. We're talking about sacrificial blood. Go back to that place in Exodus. You know what would happen in most households? They would bring that spotless, unblemished lamb into their home. Guess what that lamb soon became? A pet. Guys, we said this when we brought Ginger, our little dachshund, into our house. Yep, she's going to be an outside dog. Okay, that was number one. She's not going to sleep in anyone's bed, number two. And when we feed her, we're going to train her to be fed outside because we don't want her to make a mess. And we're going to housebreak her, and we're going to do it with the bell. She's going to bump her little nose against the bell, and we're going to let her out. Okay, of those four things that we determine to do, she does one very well. She bumps the bell. You know why she bumps the bell? Because she's always inside. She eats and drinks from the inside. And she sleeps with her lovely master, Zoe. What do you think happened to that little lamb? We've got a number of days and we're kicking around. We've got this perfect little lamb and that little sucker's jumping all over the kitchen and he's up on the table and he's in the dining room and he's in the living room and we're just celebrating life. Then on the 14th day, the first month of Nisan, at twilight, Daddy took a knife and captured that little pet and with basin at foot, rolled that head back and executed the blood of Passover. At Calvary, 2,000 years ago, when God could have, at the beck and call of his son, Father, I can't do this, would have said, Scripture says legions of angels. That's a bunch. He allowed his son's head to be high and lifted up, and naked he stood. And his blood was spilled for for you and I. He saved me from lust and ignorance, a futile way of living. Yeah, he saved me from my forefathers. But it cost him his life. And he uses the word precious. And he puts it before the word blood. In the original text, when you see the descriptor or the adjective, before you get to the actual point of the sentence, the focus, if it precedes it, it carries the weight that it's going to identify what kind of blood we're talking about. He didn't just say blood. He said precious blood. Guys, it's priceless in the sight of God. Can you imagine, for those of you who have sons? God said, the only way that I can redeem a world back to myself is you have to give your son a sacrifice for many. I don't see too many people lining up. Dads are not going to line up for that. But we had one father that did. And he gave his precious son's blood. Well, many places in Scripture that bear witness to this unblemished lamb that was sacrificed in the precious shedding of his blood. I'm not going to go to every passage, but I do want us to journey through one book, and I think it probably is the book that most clearly satisfies the understanding of the blood shed on behalf of Christ for our sin. I want to begin in Hebrews in chapter 4. If you would just quickly go there, I'm going to read just a few passages of Scripture. And Hebrews in chapter 4, the believer's rest is in Christ. In verses 14 and 15, we have an explanation of this high priest, the Son of God. In Hebrews chapter 4, beginning in verse 14, so then we have a great high priest who passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as yet we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and may find grace to help in time of need. The emphasis of this passage is Jesus Christ did not sin, yet bore the sin of all men, the precious blood of Christ. I want you to go to chapter 7, beginning of verse 26. Same book. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, because this he did once for all when he offered up himself. Look at verse 28. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, which came after the law, appoints a son made perfect forever. Go to chapter 9 very quickly, beginning in verse 12. Well, I need to go back to 11. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood. He entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For since, that's first class condition, for since the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling those who have been defiled, sanctified for the cleansing of the flesh, how much more with the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God. Cleanse yourself, or cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Drop down to, we're not going to take time. Go to chapter 10, and this will be our last, beginning in verse 1. For the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very form of things, can never, by the same sacrifices, year by year, which they offer continually, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered? Because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins year by year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when he comes into the world, he says, sacrifice and offerings thou hast not desired, but a body that thou hast prepared for me. In whole burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins thou hast taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come. In the roll of the book it is written, to do thy will, O God. And after saying above sacrifices and offerings, in whole burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast not desired, nor hast thou taken pleasure in them which are offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I have come to do thy will. He takes away the first in order to establish the second. By this will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ. When? Year by year? No. Once for all. You know what the Jews celebrate every year? Atonement. You know what Christians celebrate every year? Propitiation. Folks, atonement covered my sin from year to year. And we pray to God as the priest would go under the great place of the curtain into the Holy of Holies, that meeting place with God. And they would tie a tassel around his ankle, and out underneath the curtain they would leave a drawstring. And if he didn't come out, they had to drag him out because the sacrifice was not accepted. Or if it was, praise be to God, a nation for another year would have their sins atoned for, only to be done again and again and again. By the way, the precious blood of Christ neither stands on the sacrifice of bulls or goats ever again at Calvary. What happened to the inner sanctum, the court of the Holy of Holies, as Jesus Christ declared, it is finished. In the temple from top to bottom, we have now access to the Father because the great cloak that stood between us as a curtain was rent from top to bottom. And my dear friends, that's the precious blood that bought you and me out of slavery. And he says the precious blood, and he doesn't leave it to our imagination. Please, don't read into this any other way. He says, it's the precious blood as of a lamb, unblemished, untainted, spotless. And he says, in case you guys don't understand what I'm saying, it was the blood of Christ. Atonement, a covering. Those days are gone. Praise be to God. Let me tell you what he is to us now as our propitiation. He doesn't cover our sin. Now listen to me closely. This is the doctrine of redemption for us to leave on. He does not cover my sin at salvation. He removes it as though it never happened. Folks, did you know that? Does that mean that I won't struggle? No, that's not what that means. But the holy God of heaven looks upon my life, and he has executed a judgment upon his son that will never be executed again. And when he sees me, he sees the blood of Jesus Christ, not covering me, but separating me from my sin. A man who knew no sin became sin on my behalf, that I might not taste the condemnation of judgment upon my sin. Folks, don't leave here going, man, there's still work to be done. No, my dear friends, there's not work to be done. The work has been done. No amount of your work, no amount of your try hard, no amount of your religion will ever separate you from sin. Only the blood of Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? Because upon that, I know what I'm saved from. And I know what I was saved. Guys, I know that it's the old Florida response of some evangelists who came up with this decree, and I'm telling you, it's just unbiblical. When you stand before God, when he asks you, why should I let you into heaven, folks, you're never going to be asked that question. There's no doubt why you're there. He's not going to look at me at the judgment of the Bema seat for reward and say, now, Rob, let me go over this with you one more time. Make sure you say the right answer. Now, why are you here? Why should I let you into heaven? No, my dear friends, that's not what it's going to look like. Jesus Christ is my advocate, will stand right beside me. And the Father has willed the gift to him in my precious life through his precious blood. And there will be no question why I'm there. I'm there because of the blood of Jesus Christ. That's why I'm there. And you've heard Alistair Begg say this over and over and over. You know why I'm there? It's because the man in the middle said I could come. That's why I'm there. Folks, if you stand before him one day, there will be one reason that you were there. It's because the price of the precious blood was rolled, imputed to your account as though you had never sinned. Only the precious blood of Christ can do that. Please, I don't care what you've heard. In the past, if you're sitting here saying, I'm just holding on to that one single thread that I can be good enough for, please let it go. Plead, Father, forgive me based on your son's sacrifice. No other merit, no other reason, but the precious shed blood of Jesus Christ. See, it's not enough to shed blood. It has to be the right kind of blood. In Leviticus, actually, in, I think it's 17:11, what is blood significant of in created humanity and in the animal world? Blood is life. Life is found in the blood. Guess what? My life is found in Christ, but not just Christ, Christ's blood. Shed for me in salvation. Wendy and I were talking this morning, getting ready. My uncle used to be an arms dealer, but that takes on a whole different connotation today. He bought and sold guns and ammo, okay? He wasn't like a terrorist. He just sold stuff. He's in his 90s now, and he hasn't done this in several years, but when he was a younger man, just having just been newly wed, he was in the Navy, and he left the Navy and started his own construction business in West Texas and was doing quite well, but he's still trying to, you know, make sure that his pennies would match at the end of the month. He was living paycheck to paycheck, but they were doing well, and he ran across this 12-gauge shotgun. Being a gun dealer himself and having a passion for the study of guns, he knew that this was a very special gun. So he inquired of the man who owned the gun, hey, how much would it cost for me to buy that shotgun from you? And the guy names this price. And he thought, man, I have to sell everything I had just to buy the gun. My aunt heard a few years later that he had a passion for this 12-gauge shotgun, so they were doing much better at that time. And so she put money together and went to that same man and said, is the price still good on that shotgun? He says, oh, no, it's gone up. It'd cost you X amount to buy that gun. She paid it. For my uncle's birthday, she handed him this 12-gauge shotgun. He was just floored. Did some modifications to it, and he just loved it. It wasn't one of those he put on the mantle. He used it. It was a great shotgun. Very rare. A couple of years later, still young and married, and his house was broken into. Shotgun was stolen. He's in his 90s right now. When he was in his late 60s or early 70s, he saw his shotgun. He knew it was his. Another man owned it. And he went to him and he says, I think that was my shotgun that was stolen. Because I don't know, you know what you're talking about. I didn't steal your shotgun. I bought it from a guy downtown. He says, well, I think that's my shotgun. And he says, well, you may think it's your shotgun, but it's not your shotgun and it's not for sale. He says, oh, everything's for sale. Name your price. But he says, before you name your price, I want to check something out, if you'll let me. He says, what are you going to check out? He says, I'm going to take the plate off of the buttstock. And he had burned his initials in the end of the buttstock And he says, if it's not mine, I don't want it. But can I have the privilege or the right to take that plate off and look at that stock? And the guy says, well, sure, it's not yours. And, you know, I don't care. I didn't steal it from you. He says, I'm not saying that you did, but I think that's my shotgun. Took that plate off and burned H-H, Harley Hatch. He said, that's my initials. Pulled his driver's license out and he showed the man, that's my initials because that's my name. The guy says, okay, I'll sell it back to you. He says, oh, I'm sure you will. And he named this exorbitant amount of money. My uncle went to the bank. The guy says, I won't take anything but cash. Goes to the bank, peels off those $100 bills, and he bought his gun back. Folks, do you understand that your story? We are created in his image. In the image of him we are created. Thus we are. Somewhere in my DNA runs the Creator. He made me. And I went away. And he saw me. And he knew me. In a point in time, pre-foundationally known. On the slave auction, I stood condemned. My father was Satan. My master was evil. And I lusted hard after my flesh. I found no pleasure in godly things. I was ignorant to the gospel. My life was useless. And I was a good religious boy, but I was lost as a goose in a snowstorm. And God removed a butt plate. Found JC. That's my son. I'll buy him back. What's going to cost you a lot? I know. You do realize it's going to cost you a lot? I know. I'll pay it. And 2,000 years ago, for what he foreordained before one foundational stone was laid, he exacted a payment. For a debt I owed, I could not pay. But a debt he did not owe, and only he could pay. What's your salvation mean to you? It's just religion? That's futile? Is it works? That's ignorant? Is it trying harder? That's lost. Is it just being a good religious boy? That's what my forefathers would teach. You know what my salvation means to me? The precious blood of Jesus Christ shed that I might have life. God, I thank you for this day. Man, what a God we serve. Father, we even now find ourselves no longer condemned because of Christ, but Father, desperately seeking you. Teach us your ways. Not only that we may have a head knowledge of you, but we might have an intimate knowledge. That not only did you give your life, you gave it specifically for the elect, that we might come in faith. By repenting, it might be considered the child of the Most High King. You are Father. Father, we can never say thank you enough. But in this day, having heard from your word this morning, we just want to say thanks. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. This morning we're going to, as a church, exercise one of two ordinances left for us, that being the Lord's Supper. It is the last time that Passover would be celebrated with Jesus, by Jesus, with his group of disciples. The next time that he will celebrate around the table of Thanksgiving or the Lord's Supper will be when we are seated in His presence in a place called glory. I can't hardly wait. But He left us some instruction and in way of encouragement and correction. We want to pick up the dialogue in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Men, if you could come and tend the table. If you are a born-again, blood-bought child of God, we invite you this morning to partake in the ordinance of the Lord's Supper. Let me just tell you what it's not, and then let me remind you again what it is. It's not our table, though we may own that piece of furniture. This is the Lord's table. And so you are invited because Scripture invites you to come. And in coming, I want you to come with the understanding of what we talked about this morning. This is the to-do. Take your mind to a place called Calvary. To a place in which our Lord's flesh was pierced. First with a thorn crowned for Him as the King of the Jews. His blood would drip down His face and off of His chin and onto His bare chest, making its way to His feet in the bottom of the cross. Soldiers, as executioners, would have pinned Him there with a nail through His hand, both His left and His right. His feet would be overlapped on top and a long spike driven down through the top of both of His feet, pinned Him to the cross. Folks, we've painted such a poor picture of this. It is so violent in reality. Just as violent as it was to execute an unblemished lamb by the slitting of the throat, so our Lord was crushed. And God did not buy Him back from Satan, as some would teach. He bought Him back to Himself. It pleased Him to crush His own Son, that you and I might live. Read Isaiah 53 when you get home. It pleased the Father to execute His own Son, that I might have life. As a lamb led to slaughter, so was Jesus. Did not in any way speak against it, did not speak for Himself, but He was in an allowable, obedient act. He allowed Himself to be taken to the cross of Calvary. And there, through pierced skin, blood shed, He executed the propitiation that satisfied the demand that God placed upon all sinners. How ugly is sin? Look at Calvary. How beautiful is Christ? Look at Calvary. He both is the just and the justifier of our salvation. He's just to do it, and He is just right for the job, without spot, without blemish, no sin. So as the men make their way through the auditorium and hand out those symbols of the blood and the body of Christ, go back to that place in time. This is our story. chapter 11, 1 Corinthians and verse 1 starts this way. I'll give everybody a chance to get the cup ready. Scripture says in verse 1, be imitators of me, just as I also am of Christ. Verse 23, for I received from the Lord that which I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. Ken, would you please remember in Christ's body? Amen. Having given thanks, the scripture says he broke it, and this is what he said. This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Scripture says in the same way he took the cup. John, would you please, for the shed blood of Jesus Christ, thank him. Amen. He said this, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And the passage ends with a promise and a hope. For as oft as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I say this every time, but I don't want you to ever miss it. This is a proclamation of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for the sons and daughters of the Most High King. What am I supposed to do with this? Proclaim, herald his death. That's good news for a dying soul. But secondly, remember this. He's not finished. He'll be back. And when he does, he'll take us home. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the precious blood shed. Not for the covering of sin, but for the removal. Once for all, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ satisfies the demand that sin causes. Father, we are heirs and joint heirs. We're recipients of your amazing grace. Today, I pray we would herald the good news of Jesus Christ by proclaiming your death with anticipation of your return. Come even now, Lord Jesus. Come quickly. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Rob.
Yep.
We're going to end with Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. If you'll stand and sing. Like me.
Next Sunday, we will look at verses 20 and 21. Who redeemed us? When? And for what purpose are we redeemed? As you go through the remainder of this week, remember the price that was paid for you. To be who you are in Christ, never take that for granted. Remember the activities of this week on Tuesday and then Wednesday and Thursday and Saturday. And I know it's busy. Men, please bring your sons. If you have sons at home or neighbor boys or whatever, we want you to have breakfast on us. But we want to begin to pray as men of this church that would seek the Father, that He would do a mighty work that we can't explain. We can just know. Father, I thank You for this day again, and for the beauty of Your Son, and for the execution of a plan long before creation was spoken. As the psalmist would write, with the mighty arm of God, we've been saved. Thank You for Your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed. Hey, girl.
Hi.
How are you? That's it. Hey, thank you for serving. Thank you guys for serving. That was good.